Amen. Can you all hear me in the back? I'm not really a microphone preacher, but I'll do my best. All right, Romans chapter 7. Barney kind of gave you a clue to what we're going to be covering here. And we're going to get right down to it. Romans 7, let's start at verse 18. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth what?
No good thing.
No good thing. I like to use my Bible to define itself. That word dwelleth, it comes up the first time in your Bible in Leviticus 19:34. It says, but the stranger that dwelleth with you shall be unto you as one being among you. The word dwelleth means lives. It's not complicated. So in other words, Paul says, in my flesh lives what?
No good thing.
Do you believe that? Yeah. Let's just start right there, guys. Because if you don't believe that, that's fine. I have another verse for you. Paul said, if a man think himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceiveth who?
Himself.
So here's your fork in the road. Either you can acknowledge that in your flesh is no good thing, or you're deceived. Amen? Choice is yours. I know there's nothing good in this but Christ. Amen? So I can move on, and I'm praying you move on with me. So let's look at Romans 7:20. Paul says, now if I do that, I would not. Meaning, if I do the things that I don't really want to do, he says, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. He says, sin's living in me. And now look, he gets a conclusion here. He says, I find then, he just discovered something by knowing this. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. So Paul just discovered that there's this inner man who loves God, loves the things of God. We call that man the spiritual man. And then there's also this thing happening where there's evil present with Paul. We call that the outward man or the natural man, right? And so look at verse 23. He says, I see another law in, underline that, my members warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is where? Okay, so we're getting somewhere. We're under a war here, guys. There's a war happening in your body. What's the war, preacher? There's a law of your mind, and it's at a war that's at a law in your members. Amen? So there's really a law of God that's battling a law of sin. And now look what Paul says. A wretched man that I am, because he's discovered this, and he doesn't like it. Can you acknowledge there's sin in you? Can you acknowledge there's no good thing in you? Then you've experienced this passage. You've experienced feeling wretched. Amen? He says, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the what? The body. It's in the members. Who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Paul's realizing this thing is causing death in me. There's no life in it. Amen? Who? Paul's asking for that old-fashioned religion deliverance. I need delivered from this thing. And a lot of people end the chapter there. But it doesn't end, does it? All right, what's he say next? I thank God. Paul's going to get some deliverance here. Through who? There he is. There's the deliverer, guys. Y'all know that. I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. There's the thankful. There's the deliverer. And now he's going to tell you how. He says, so then with the what?
Mind.
Underline that. Underline it twice, three times. Crucially important for your Christian walk to understand that word mind there. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of what? He just told you how this thing's going to function. He just told you how you're going to serve God. Amen. It's what your mind. Why? Because there's nothing good in this thing. It's got to come from the mind. This thing's only going to cry out for deliverance. This thing's only going to reveal your wretchedness. Amen. Now look at 8. About to get some help. Paul says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the what?
Spirit.
He just gave you a conditional passage right there. You know how I know that? Because I myself live my conscience condemning me when I am living after the flesh. So I experience condemnation. It's not a positional only passage, guys, because I have condemnation in my life when I'm not walking after the Spirit, and that's a good thing.
Amen.
It is good to live of a good conscience, of a pure conscience. That it's the way we are led of the Spirit, right? A lot of people have made that positional only. It's not, and it's crucially important that you all understand that. Because look what he's about to say next. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made what? Me. For the longest time, I taught this passage with application to Eric. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free, right? Mm-mm. Look at it. Paul doesn't say you. He does not say us. What's the pronoun? Me. Meaning Paul is free. Amen? Okay. Well, now that we've identified Paul is made free from that law of sin and death, we got to determine how he did it, right? So look, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ hath made Paul free from the law of sin. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh. And right there I'm like, what are you talking about, Paul? You know what? What could the law not do? Right? Well, he says in... I got lost in my notes here. For... I must have it on the page. I'll find it. It's in Galatians. If you want to flip with me, it's in Galatians 3, I believe. He says, 3:21, is the law then against the promises of God? God forbid. That's a resounding no. For if there had been a law given which could have given what?
Life.
Verily, righteousness should have been by the law, but the Scripture hath concluded, all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. Amen. So what that law could not do is that law could not make you free from sin and death. And therefore, that law could never give you life. Amen. It can't. It's impossible, guys. That's why Paul calls Moses a minister of death. And he calls Moses a minister of condemnation. That's all the law will ever produce for you. Condemnation and death. But Paul told you there's freedom. There's a law of a spirit of life in Christ that makes us free from this law of sin and death. And now look. He says God. So the flesh is, the law is only weak through us, through the flesh, right? There's nothing wrong with the law. The law is holy and just and good. Law's not the problem. We are. So what'd God do about it? He tells you. God, sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. He did something we could never do. And see that colon there? It's very, very important. Now He's going to tell you what that condemnation of sin accomplished. See that word? That, circle it. That is a purpose word in your Bible. It's usually like a conclusory word. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the what? There it is again. That's that same terminology that he opened up the chapter with. So at this point, I'm like, what is this walking after thing, right? He's telling us how to do this thing. We're just going to have to define what that means. Thank you, Paul. He defines it in the next verse. Look at it. For they that are after the flesh do what? There it is. He just told you in chapter 7, you're going to serve the law of God through the mind. He's cluing you in. This is how it's going to function, guys. The whole thing is in your mind. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is what? Well, you can probably draw a conclusion now without even reading the Bible. If carnal minding is death, what's spiritual minded going to be? Life. He tells you it's also peace. Amen. Was that Justin hit on that? Trying to steal your life and peace. Here it is, guys. There's a law in Christ that's going to give you those things. It cannot ever be given to you through the flesh or through a performance-based law system. You'll only ever die to that. Amen. Look down at Romans 8:11. I'm not going to do a whole message on this chapter, but Paul writes, but if the Spirit of Him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, and I'm like, okay, where's dwelling coming up, right? We already did dwelleth. Maybe this means something different. It really does, and it first comes up. I can't even read my note, but it's Old Testament. It's Jabal. I bet you Billy knows who that is. Jabal, it says, he was a father of such as dwell in tents. So that one means live. It's not complicated. So I'm like, okay, here we go. If a spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead, other words, live in you, right? I'm not changing your Bible. I'm just trying to give you understanding. Comparing spiritual things with spiritual, right? Because it's better that I speak 5 words of my understanding to you than 10,000 words in an unknown tongue. So I'm trying to make this easy to be understood. Dwell is key to the passage, guys. It is. I used to teach this as positional only as well, and it's not. That dwelling is crucially important, and we'll hit on that more later. But if the Spirit of Him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, He that raised up Christ from the dead shall, that's a promise or a declaration, shall also quicken, that means to make alive, shall quicken your mortal bodies by His Spirit that what? So it's that Spirit of Christ in you that's going to make you alive. Amen? And it's got to dwell in you, guys. That's key to the passage. You know why? Because for the believer, there's 3 ways the Spirit is going to function in your life. Do you know what they are? Paul taught it. He taught that that you can grieve the Spirit. You've heard of that? He taught that you can quench the Spirit. Amen? And He taught that you can be what? Filled with the Spirit. Amen. So that kind of tells you it's a sliding scale, right? And He's saying, dwell in you. This is what you need to be looking for. And then He says, therefore, so that's what we're looking for, having this Spirit dwell in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh, to live after the flesh, man. And I was raised a Catholic. I often think of them when I come across that passage, and I'll tell you why. You would pray or you would confess to the priest in a little box. And what's funny about that experience is nobody's writing down their sins as they go through life. So you have to tell them all your sins, and you don't know what they are. So you just go in and start lying, making it up. So I lied 47 times, and I looked at a woman and lost 12, you know, and he'd be like, okay, son, you sinned. Go and say 10 Our Fathers and 12 Hail Marys. I don't really remember. It was something like that. He's literally giving you like a bill. Go pay this debt back to the flesh. Amen. That's what they do. They're debtors to the flesh, guys, living after their flesh. And Paul's telling you, you're not this anymore. This thing's done. This thing's nailed to the cross on Calvary. It's already condemned. You don't have to deal with it anymore. Christ did it for you. Amen. Move on. We got bigger things to do in this thing. You with me? Y'all awake tonight?
Amen.
Because Paul tells you, here's your fork in the road. For if you live after the flesh, ye shall what?
Die.
I'm sorry, but those Catholics are living a life of death. They are living after death, man, minding the things of the flesh. You're not to do that, Christian. You're to be a spiritual man. Here's your other fork. But if ye notice it, circle this, through the Spirit, do mortify, kill the deeds of the body, ye shall what?
Live.
I used to read that, mortify the sins, right? And that's not what Paul said, is it? He said deeds. You know what deeds are? It's everything you do, everything. Not just your sin. You're not just, because that's what that is. That's death too. When I'm just living my life and I'm just, oh, don't sin, sin conscience. I'm living after the flesh still. I'm minding my flesh. Paul says through the Spirit, that whole thing's going to be killed. All your deeds, man. You're done. You're in the ground, guys. You're crucified with Christ. Amen. This is a crucially missing teaching in the church. Even a lot of grown up Christians aren't living the life of Christ. They are living a life unto themselves. And they're living a life of condemnation and death. Amen. Go to Ephesians 4. I mean, we could put the lost world in this. We could put a lot of Christians in this. Paul uses the term other Gentiles. Ephesians 4, 17. He says, this I say therefore and testify in the Lord. That's a very profound statement. You know what? Testimony is, it's almost like a courtroom statement, right? Like I'm bearing record here, okay? That ye henceforth, that means from here on forward, that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk in the vanity of their what? You see the connection yet? You know what a vain mind is? It's empty. It's bare. It has no value. There's no fruit to it. It's useless. He's saying, this is how they're walking. And he's not telling you it's a walk of the flesh. He's not using sin as you would think here. He's saying what? They got a vain mind. Amen. And that vain mind is what he's using to show you how they walk. Do you see how that walk and mind is connected? Look what he says next. Having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through what? They don't know anything. They're ignorant. They can't prove the will of God. Some people don't even know it's in here, like Barney said. That they're ignorant. That's a darkened understanding. And he tells you why. Look at it. Because of the blindness of their what? That shows you there's a mind and heart connection in people. Right? A blinded heart will give you a vain mind through a darkened understanding. You with me? He says, who being past feeling, I mean, they can't feel anything anymore. They're beyond it. They can't feel. Have given themselves over unto lasciviousness to work all uncleanness with greediness. But ye, church, have not so learned Christ. Christ didn't teach you this, guys. You're not to walk with a vain mind. You're not to have a darkened understanding. You're not to have a blind heart. Amen? Christ ain't teaching you that. That's them, Paul says. You don't walk like them. Amen? If so be, there's one of Barney's looking for those, what do we call them, brother? Those conditions. If so be that ye have heard him. Have you heard Jesus this weekend? Amen. And have been taught by him. Have you been taught by the Lord? You're meeting this condition. What is it, Paul? As the truth is in Jesus, that ye put off concerning the former conversation, the old man, that natural man, right? Which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust. He just told you right there, there's no reconciling this thing. It's corrupt. You ain't going to deal with it through willing it to do better. Amen? Amen? And that ye put on the new man. But wait, preacher, you missed the verse, right? On purpose, he told you put one off, put one on, and there's one in the middle. What's that tell us, guys? That's going to unlock how you do it, right? So what is it? And be renewed in the spirit of what? Your mind. That mind is the key to this whole thing, guys. The whole Christian walk is going to function up here. And what's going on up here, you're going to see outwardly in this thing, right? So there it is. We got to learn to be renewed in this spirit of our mind. So I'm like, okay, that's Paul's laying out the darkened and what not to do. What's the contrast, right? Well, Paul, how are we to walk? Go to Ephesians 5, 15. See then that ye walk circumspectly. Do you ever look into that word? It's really two words put together. Circum, which is all around, and speckly is like vision or your eyes. So he's saying, you're to walk with eyes, being able to see everything around you. Full understanding, full comprehension to what's going on here. This is how you're to walk. Not as fools, but as what? Wise. You're wise sons now. You're not like those other Gentiles walking around in vanity. And look what he says next. Redeeming the time. You know, Christ purchased you, right? Do you know that? That you're not your own anymore? So you need to redeem your time now. It's been a gift given to you by the Lord's own blood. Amen. It's very important to understand that, man. You start to purchase back. That's what redeem means. I'm going to buy back my time. So this is our enlightenment, our enlightened understanding. What is it an understanding of? He's going to tell you, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding what? There it is. So now we're going to understand what the will of the Lord is. That understanding, that enlightenment is going to allow us to start redeeming time. And that is going to be how we walk circumspectly. Amen? It's beautiful, guys. Look what he says next. And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be. Don't do this, do this. What is it? Be filled with what? Spirit. And it's sad that I have to even preach on this, but some people don't understand it. What is he talking about? What even is being filled with the Spirit? Some people right now in a church somewhere are just trying to call down like it's a lost puppy or something. Back, Fido, fall on us, Lord. Is that what the Spirit is? Is that how I get filled up with this Spirit? I'll say it, Christ said it like this. It is the Spirit that what? Quickeneth, makes alive. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Well, that's Christ, preacher. That's not for us, right? Paul said it like this, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is what?
The Word of God.
The Word of God. You cannot disconnect the Word of God with His Spirit, the one. So when we're talking to you about being filled with the Spirit, right here. I'm holding it in my hand. He means get this thing in this. Stuff it in there. Be filled with that thing, right? That's what he really does mean, guys. It's not some emotional religious experience. It's knowledge of the Son of God in your mind, right? So we're to be filled with the Word of God. And when you start to get filled with the Word of God, boy, it's going to make some changes for you. I'm going to give you a passage you should know. It's in 1 Peter chapter 2. preach on this often because it's crucially important. And right here, people are like, but preacher, that's in Peter. We don't read that stuff. That's for the Hebrews, right? All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for what, guys? Doctrine. Behold, I give you good doctrine. Right? It's good stuff, guys. Did I say 1 Peter? Yeah, chapter 2. Start at verse 18. Servants. Isn't that how Paul began Romans, whole ministry? Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ? Amen? Okay. So the apostle considered himself a servant. Let's keep reading. Servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the who? Oh boy, you ever read up on froward? That sucks, guys. That passage is rough. You know why? Froward, man, is like completely impossible. He's unyielding. He's not to be governed. And you're probably thinking, he's talking about my boss. My boss is absolutely out of control. And Peter's saying here, you're not to just be subject to good people, guys. You're to be subject to the impossible. Right? Amen, preacher. Why? For this is thankworthy. If a man for conscience towards God, you see, it has nothing to do with that froward man. It has everything to do with God. If a man for conscience towards God endure grief, suffering what? And I always get very, very convicted right now. Right? And then he teaches you, for what glory is it if when you be buffeted for your faults, you shall take it patiently? It's no big deal if you do something wrong and get in trouble for it. Right? That's what you should expect. But if when you do well and suffer for it, you take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. Why? Look at the next verse. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. And I'm just like, man, that's rough, right? I got to do better. And this is what happens to me. I'll tell you a little story. We started up a street preaching ministry since coming back from Paul's conference. And a guy the other day come up to us. He said, I love what you're doing, man. I want to kind of come out. He didn't say it in the perfect words, but you can tell he wanted to join us. Right? And he said, you got a church? And I said, yeah, come to church, you know? And he said, I am. I'm going to come to church. And I got really excited because I've been preaching faithfully for like a year, and we've had not only no growth, I think I've lost people, honestly. I think we had more people in the church when I started. But trust me, that's what this doctrine will do. That's fine. Amen. I'll take my treasures up there. But I'm excited. I'm like, oh, I'm so thankful. And strangely enough, guys, I'm teaching Romans 1:1. What a perfect time to come to church, right? And this guy comes to church, and I got a message prepared, and he walks in my house. And mind you, my church is my home. I don't have a church. My wife bought me a 12-foot whiteboard. We turned my wall, my living room wall, into a whiteboard. We moved the couch, and that's where I preach. I invited him into my home. Church is about to go live. He showed up 10 minutes early, and he walked in my house. I had my cameras for the online ministry, and he walked in, and the first thing he did, he sat down. He said, I'm not trying to poo-poo on what you're doing here, but you really shouldn't do that, and the internet is of the devil, and you're causing brethren to stumble, and Satan's the prince of the power of the air. And I was like, Is God say who will have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of truth or not? I mean, I felt, guys, the blood come up through my neck and start pulsing out my ears and eyeballs. I'm not even kidding you. It was intense. I got so offended, so upset. This guy has no idea who I am. He has no idea the labor I do in the Lord. And he just walks right in my home and starts judging me unrighteously. And then I calmed down a little bit. And I'm like, I got two verses for you, man. I'm like, Paul said I'd have you wise unto that which is good and simple concerning evil. So calm down. And the second one I said is a shame even to speak of those things which are done to them in secret. Because that's what he's doing. Exposing all the devil and its devices. And guys, I did it too. So I can speak onto it with authority. Until somebody pointed out, Eric, if you're just on YouTube and bitch shoot all day, learning about the devil and then telling people what he's doing in secret, you actually have a ministry of shame. And I'm like, wow, amen. Submitted to that word. I'm done doing that. And so the guy actually took it with okay correction. He wrote them down. He said, I'm going to dig into that later. And I preached my message, and he went home. But after he left, man, I couldn't deal with it. And I said, family, I handled that terribly. And they said, not really, Dad. I didn't say anything crazy. You gave him a couple of verses. I said, I'm not talking about what I said. I said, my inner man was filled with rage. I handled it like you can't. I said, the thoughts I had towards that man, I'm a minister, guys. I'm a preacher. I'm a pastor. I was like, that's not acceptable. And I started to be in that oh, wretched man state. And I couldn't shake it either. I mean, the whole day went on. I went to bed with that man on my conscience. I woke up with that man on my conscience. And I even know the verses that there's no condemnation if I'm walking after the Spirit, and I couldn't shake this. And I called up my preacher and my best friend, and I said, guys, here's what happened. And you guys might know Paul Lucas, man. He's a great preacher. I love him dearly. And he said to me, he said, first, I'll tell you the worst I would have said to that man. He said, I know and am persuaded by the Lord Jesus that there is nothing unclean of itself. And I was like, dang, I wish I had that one floating around at the time. You know, that was fantastic. What do you even say to that? Right? Because that just snubs that legalist mind right away. You know what he said to me next? And this one was for me when he said it. I knew it right away. He said, Brother Eric, this is Titus 1:15 if you're taking notes. He said, Brother Eric, unto the pure, all things are pure. He said, but unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure, but even their mind and conscience is defiled. He said, Brother Eric, you see, the reason why that man walked into your house and immediately started condemning is because he has a defiled conscience. He said, he probably has issues with the internet or who knows what, but his own mind thinks you got to serve God like the Statue of Liberty or like a monk just in a white room with nothing on it. Just, I'm not sinning. He said he comes in because nothing's pure to him. And he starts to condemn everything you're doing because he didn't even stop there. What really made me mad is he said, my family wears Jesus clothing all the time. My wife's truck has scripture all over it. He goes, you're not even supposed to have like scripture in your... And once you take shots at my family, I'm sorry, I'm person too. I got really mad. But when Paul Lucas showed me that, I realized it instantaneously made me feel the wrath being put off, and it started to put on pity for the man, mercy for the man, because I realized he's unbelieving. He doesn't know this stuff, right? He's in a wretched state. I felt the bitterness get purged out of me, and I started to feel compassion and forgiveness. When he left, I hoped I'd never seen him again. And after Lucas admonished me with this truth, I thought there's no better place for him than back in the church. And I hope he comes when I return home. You see what this word of God is able to do, guys? It changes you, man. And this is why that word dwell is so important. Because I should have those verses in me. Paul had to give them to me. And I got to work on that. Right? But you see how it's able to effectually worketh in them that believe. Right? And when that happened, after it was all done, I had a moment where I realized I was just renewed in the spirit of my mind. That's what Paul's talking about. I saw it in real time, God. I love this book, man. I love what God's doing down here. I love the church, man. I love to teach this stuff to you guys. There's life in these words, man. They're not mine. They're Jesus Christ's life. So How do we get that victory over this sin nature, right? Go to Romans chapter 6. Chapter 6 and verse, we'll start at, let's see. We'll just inject in at 14, even though it starts with a 4. For sin shall not have dominion over you. And a lot of times people will quote this passage, but they leave that part out, right? For ye are not under the law, but under what? Skip back to 5:21. That as sin hath reigned, past tense, not reigning right now, unto death, even so might what? Grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. Hebrews 4 says, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Grace is on the throne, y'all. It's not just this ether thing. Grace is on the throne. His name is Jesus Christ, and He's reigning. So that the way people are teaching is they're over grace. I can do whatever I want, right? Doesn't matter. No, you're under Him, guys, and He's reigning. Okay? So now you are not under the law, but under grace. What then? So what can we say back to that? What's the teaching, Paul? Shall we sin? That means I can sin, right? It doesn't matter. So we sin because we're not under the law, but under grace. What's he tell you? God forbid that. I forbid you to think like that. How dare you think like that? That's the teaching. No, that's not what I'm saying, in other words. Know ye not. Okay, it's clearly, if you're thinking like that, you're missing something. You're missing some knowledge. What is it? Know ye not, in other words, don't you know this? Haven't you figured this out yet? What? That to whom ye yield yourselves, servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto what? So you have a choice, guys. You have a choice. Who you're going to yield to. Amen? Paul tells you that. But look at the next verse. I love this verse, man. But God be thanked that ye were, past tense, the servants of sin. But ye have what? Obeyed from the heart. Remember we showed you that mind-heart connection? Amen? You obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you, being then made free from sin. You became the servants of righteousness. Paul just told you how you're going to be made free from sin. Did he not? Did he not just say it? Well, how? What was it? I missed it, preacher. He said, you obeyed from the heart that what? Okay. I guess we got to do a message on what is form of doctrine, right? If that's what makes us free from sin, amen. That's really a series message, but I did the work for you. I'll give you the cliff notes, we used to call them. The old heads know what that is. It's like the summary, right? And it's really this whole book, but we'll just start with Paul's doctrine for now. Romans, what is it? It's our foundation and establishment into the faith. Amen. 1 Corinthians. It's to deal with our carnality and divisions in the church. 2 Corinthians, this one is actually hard if you read it. I come up with comfort and understanding. Amen. What's Galatians for, preacher? To make sure we are not foolishly striving to be made perfect by the flesh, which is what Paul is teaching you in 7 and 8 Romans. It's a transition epistle. They're trying to grow you up from children to sons. And he introduces the new creature in Galatians. Ephesians, it's revelation of that new creature. We call that the new man. Beseechment to walk worthy of that calling. And it's preparation for for conflict. And people who are growing up into this doctrine are like, amen. I see it, preacher. Conflict. You're in it. Not you, specifically, the new man. Jesus Christ is in conflict, guys. That's why you're putting on the armor of God there. Okay, so what's Philippians for? Striving together for the faith of the gospel with one mind and one spirit, and it's perfecting our knowledge of the Son of God. Amen. Colossians, what is it? Continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and it's for perfecting our walk in the bond of perfectness. Amen. So the new man is really walking correctly by Colossians. There's seven epistles there. And you're walking in faith, hope, and charity now. Well, if that's true, preacher, what on earth are Thessalonians for? That doesn't even make any sense. I'll tell you, Thessalonians is an example of a perfect church. 1 Thessalonians is for your patience of hope and to abound more and more. 2 Thessalonians is that ye be not soon shaken in mind or troubled, and for the obtaining the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because that's the doctrine of the Apostle Paul that he lays out. That's the form to this thing. There really is a course of study through the different epistles. And he's saying when you obey from the heart, that you're made free from sin. Now you're up to a heart check. Whose heart wants to submit to that? Whose heart wants to go and watch YouTube? Your choice, y'all. I'm just a preacher, man. I'm just showing you what God showed me. It's going to come down to you. Go to Colossians 3. We'll make a couple more points and we'll wrap it up. I can show you how I know it's a course too, through this chapter. Verse 1, if ye be risen with Christ, seek those things which are where?
Above,
where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection, singular as Billy would say, on things above, not on things in the earth. For ye are what?
Dead.
It's not you anymore, guys. You're in the ground. Your old man's hung on the cross with Christ. Ye are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. Are you risen? Are you? Because it's not positional, guys. Risen with Christ is not just given to you. Paul said that. Audible. Go to Philippians 3. Look at 8. Paul tells you how he perfected his knowledge of Christ. Yay. 3:8. Yea, doubtless I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. Paul started to realize, man, that stuff is hindering me. I don't care about that anymore. I just want to know Him. Amen? He says, and be found in Him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the what? The law. But that which is through the faith of Christ. Faith of Christ, not in. Of Christ.
Amen.
The righteousness which is of God. His righteousness. That's why Romans 3 is declaring His righteousness. It's God's righteousness. We're not. We just have to submit to that. His righteousness, which is of God by faith. Amen. Colon. Now he's going to get to the crux. That I may know Him and the power of His resurrection. Guys, and he doesn't just mean the power of Him being raised from the dead. Yes, that's part of it. But there's a resurrected life of the Savior that's still happening today.
Right.
Guys, He's alive right now. He's not dead anymore.
Right.
That's the power of His resurrection, right? And the fellowship of His sufferings. And we could go deep there, but we won't. So there's a life there and there's a death there too. That's what he means. How do you know that? Preacher doesn't say it. Sure it does. Read it. Being made conformable unto what?
His death.
You understand? Being made is like a process. It's like an ongoing process. were being made conformable unto his death. And now he says, if by any means. So those three things. I got to know him. I got to know the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. If by any means I might attain unto what? Paul is not like, boy, I hope I get resurrected and go and meet there in the Lord when he raptures a church. Paul's like, I'm not sure if I'm saved. I hope. No. That's the resurrection there is not the rapture of the church. Paul is attaining unto this life of Christ. Paul is attaining unto this risenness with his Savior. Amen. He's still chasing after something, guys. And look what he says next. Not as though I had already attained. What did you already attain, Paul? He told you the knowledge of Christ, the excellency of it. He has that one, okay? Either we're already perfect, but I follow after. If that I may apprehend, that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. What is he following after? He's going to tell you. Brethren, I love this about Paul. It's his humility. I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. Guys, I'm not there yet, but I got this figured out. What is it, Paul? Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. He says, let us therefore, as many as be perfect, if you have that perfected knowledge of the Son of God, be thus minded. And if anything ye be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Nevertheless, here's a wrapping up of the teaching. Nevertheless, whereunto we have already attained, let us what? Walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same thing. Do you see the connection? Mind to heart, guys. The mind will perfect the walk. Amen? It's there. So back to Colossians. That is if ye be risen, man. You see the attaining unto the resurrection of the dead. That's why it's a condition, guys. Right? Look at 3:5. Mortify, therefore, your members which are upon the earth. Fornication, uncleanness. And I go down through the list, right? You probably don't need me to. You probably read this. He tells you for which thing's sake, for those very sins' sake, the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. Whoa. In other words, how dare you do those things if that kind of stuff is going to throw people into an eternal lake of fire, right? He's giving you knowledge, man, to be different. Walk not as other Gentiles walk in the vanity of their mind, right? So he lays that out and he says, in the which ye also, get it, walked. See how that's past tense? I have the ED underlined there because it's crucially important. Ye also walked sometime when ye what? Lived. Past tense in them. But now ye also put off all these. And Eric gets very convicted at this point. Anger, wrath, malice. And I start saying, oh, gotta do better, preacher. You know, you feeling that? The stuff in the first part, guys, it doesn't really, I don't struggle with that as much anymore. I'm forgetting those things that are behind. But my own emotions, man, they trip me up. They trip me up all the time, you know. But stay with me. So you have those filthy communications, he says, lie not one to another. Now get it. Next four words are black as night on my page. Seeing that ye have put off the old man. Okay. With his deeds and have put on the new man. I don't understand why you're emphasizing that, preacher. Flip back. Hold that in your hand and flip back to Ephesians 4. And now look at 22. Notice that starts with a that ye put off. Okay, look at 24. that ye put on. That's like Paul saying, do this. That ye do this. Now flip back to Colossians. You see it? Seeing that ye have put off. Ye have put on. It's done now by Colossians. You're now a grown up son. You're not acting in vanity like the other Gentiles. This one should be completed by this point. Amen? There's a reason he changes that word, guys. It's further in your epistles for a reason. And have put on the new man. It's done now, which is renewed in what? Knowledge. Back to the mind. Renewed in the what? Spirit of your mind. After the image of him that who? Created him. There's that Barney's being conformed to that perfect image of the Son of God, where there is neither Greek nor Jew. We're not concerned with bloodlines anymore and family names and these things that just are fleshly and they don't matter. Why? Look at the end of the passage. But Christ is all and in all. It's all about him, guys. It doesn't matter what skin color you are or heritage you're from or background you have. It's all about Jesus Christ. He's everything, man. Put on, therefore, here's the teaching, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies. And there's this beautiful list going forth, right? And I'm always reading them like, I got to be more humble and be more meek and long-suffering. You know what ends up happening with that? You know, forbearing one another. I start to be like, I got to do better, right? Wrong. You got to believe the Word of God. You got to be crucified with Christ. I can't do any of these things. We always often think like, you got to will out the sin, right? I got to will better and get the bad stuff out. You can't, first of all. You can't. But here's the flip side to it. You also cannot will in the good stuff, man. It's only Jesus Christ that's going to do it for you. Paul taught you that in Ephesians. He said, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth. Amen. So you got to be careful turning this stuff into like a law of Paul, I call it, right? I'm turning Paul's epistles into a list of commandments. I do that stuff, guys, so I can teach on it. Careful. Because you're now placing yourself back under a performance system, no different than the law of Moses. And guess what that's going to produce for you? Sin and death. Condemnation and death. Every time. You got to hone in on that fruit of the Spirit being all goodness and righteousness and truth. Right? So we really just have to learn some things, guys. We got to get our minds right. We got to seek after that excellency of the knowledge of Christ first. Then once you can get that under control, you can begin to account it. Paul uses the word reckon it, right? That's basically believe it, know it, and account it, believe it. And then you got to yield, right? You're left at that fork, right? I have that sometimes, guys. As I'm living my life, the Word of God bubbles up my inner man. It reproves me and says, stop doing that. And then I have a choice. I might stop doing it, I might not. And it shows whether I'm obedient or yielded unto sin or of obedience unto righteousness. Amen. We all have a choice with that. So you got to start to learn to yield your heart to the Spirit of God. Because your heart is desperately wicked. Amen. Doesn't Jeremiah say that? The heart is deceitful above what? All things. It means your heart should be the scariest thing in the world to you. If it's deceitful above everything, right? Your own heart. That's why you need to know that in your flesh dwelleth no good thing. Amen? Go to Romans 8. Last passage. I just want to get eyes on your page for this. (Clears throat) This is really what it all comes down to, guys, right here. 8:14. For as many as are, underline it, led by the Spirit of God, underline this, they are the sons of God. What do you mean, preacher? I'm saved. I'm a son of God. Are you? I'm not saying you're not saved, guys. Look at 16. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we, get that pronoun, we are the what? He didn't say we up in 14 now, did he? Look at it. Did he say we? No, he said they. Meaning those sons who are being led by God's Spirit, God accounts them as sons. The rest are children. So I just beg you to ask yourself, are you a child or are you a son? Amen. That's all I got.